The Upanishad series. Energy phenomena in death. Death is one shore of. It is culmination of life. It is crescendo. And when your life has been of total awareness, then when death is there, you have to be respectful, because death is no ordinary phenomenon. Death is no ordinary phenomenon. Death is the most extraordinary phenomenon in the entire universe. The most extraordinary phenomenon. Nothing is more mysterious than passing of an individual. When soul leaves the body, death reaches to the very center of existence. And when a man is no more physically alive, he is moving on sacred ground. Indeed, death is the holiest moment possible. Ordinary curiosities cannot be allowed. They are disrespectful. In the East particularly, death is respected more than life. And the East has lived long to come to this conclusion. In the West, life is more respected than death. As a result, there is so much tension, worry, anguish, and so much madness. Why? If you respect life more, you will be afraid of death. Because death will take away all that life gives. It takes away the opportunity to live. And then death will look antagonistic or enemy to life. Certainly, if death is the enemy, you will remain throughout the whole life, because death can happen any moment. You do not accept it and you go on rejecting it. But you cannot destroy it. Death cannot be destroyed. You can go on rejecting it. You can go on denying it. You can be afraid and scared of it, but it is there, just at the corner, always with you, like a shadow. It follows life like a shadow. You go on trembling your whole life and in the fear. In all fears, if search deeply, you will find fear of death is the greatest. Whenever you are afraid, something has given you an indication of life. If your bank goes bankrupt, you are filled with fear and trembling. Anxiety, that too represents anxiety about death, because your bank balance was nothing but a security against death. Now you are more open and vulnerable. Now who will protect you if death knocks at the door? If you become ill or you become old, then who is going to take care of you? The guarantee was in the bank. Now the bank has gone banker. You cling to prestige, power, and position because when you have a position, you are so significant that you are more protected by the people. When you are not in power, you become so important that nobody bothers in any way about you. When you are in power, you have friends, family, and followers. And when you are not, everybody leaves you. There was a protection. Somebody was there to care, and now nobody cares. Whatsoever you are afraid of, if you search deeply, you will always find that the death somewhere goes on following you like a shadow. You cling to a husband or to a wife. You are afraid he or she may leave you one day. What is the fear? Is this really the fear of divorce, or is it the fear of death? It is always the fear of death, because in divorce you become alone. The other gives protection, a feeling that you are not alone. Somebody else is with you. In moments when somebody else will be needed, you will have somebody to look to. But the wife has left or the husband has left. Now you are left alone, a stranger. Who will protect you? Who will care for you when you are ill? When people are young, they do not need a wife or a husband so much. But when they are old, the need is more. When you are young, it is more like a sexual relationship. The older you become, the more it becomes a life relationship. Because now if the other leaves you, immediately death is there. And it has been discovered that the moment one of the person dies, within a short period of time, the other two follows. It is like a game of cricket. The two batsmen are playing in harmony with one another. There is a rapport, a deep understanding, a bondage. The moment one dies, in most of the cases, the other becomes vulnerable, and within a short period of time, the other two die. Other two gets out. It has been observed if one partner, husband or wife, dies, within a period of few months to 6 months, the other also dies. Very rarely it happens that even after the death of one partner, the other lives on. Wherever you are afraid, you look deep within and you will find death hiding somewhere behind. All fear is of death. Death is the only source of fear. In the West, people are very scared, worried and anxious because you have to fight continuously against death. You love life. You respect life. That is why in the West, old people are not respected. Younger ones are given respect because old people have moved further towards death than you. They are already in the grip of death. Youth is respected in the West. Youth is a transitory phenomenon. It is already passing from your hands. In the East, old persons are respected because in the East, death is respected. Because in the East, death is respected and there is no fear about death. Life is just one aspect of death. Life is just one part. Death is the culmination. Life is just the process and death is the crescendo. Life is just the moving. Death is the reaching. Both are one. So what will you respect more? The way or the goal? The process or the flowering? Death is the flower that grows on the tree of life, and the tree is always there for the flower. Tree exists for the flower. The flower is not there for the tree, but the tree exists for flower. The tree should be happy and the tree should dance when the flowers come. The tree begins to dance the moment flowers appear. So in the East, death is accepted, not only accepted but is welcomed. It is a divine guest. When it knocks at the door, it means the universe is ready to receive you back. In the East, we respect death. And this young man just came in without even expressing a word of sympathy or respect. He simply became curious. Not only that, he was very disrespectful. He tapped the coffin and asked the Zen master Dozo, "Is he really dead?" His question is beautiful, but not in the right moment. The question is right, but the moment he has chosen is wrong. To be curious before death is childish. One has to be respectful and silent. That is the only way to have a rapport with the phenomenon. When somebody dies, it is really something very deep is happening. If you can sit there and meditate, many things will be revealed to you. It is suggested that when you sit around a dying person, you begin with the recitation of Durud Sharif or meditation. Many things will be revealed to you, but questioning at that time is foolish. When death is there, why not meditate? Questioning may be just a trick to avoid the thing. It may be just a safety measure so as not to look at the death directly. When the masters leave the world, they allow their closest disciple Khalifas to remain around. I have watched when people go to burn or to cremate somebody, they start talking too much there. At the cremation ground, they discuss many philosophical things. Whenever I visit the funeral, the man is not my concern. Instead, death is my concern. It is such a beautiful phenomenon and one of the most mysterious one. One should not miss it. So during the moments of cremation, I would be there always watching, waiting and witnessing what is happening. And I watched people discussing many things, philosophical problems, such as what is death, and somebody should say nobody dies, the innermost self is immortal, and they would discuss the Upanishads, the Gita, the Qurans and quote authorities. I start feeling they are all avoiding. By just becoming engaged in discussion, they are avoiding the phenomena that is happening. They are not looking at the dead man. And the thing is there, death is there, and you are discussing it. What fools are these? Something is happening and you are discussing about it. You have to be silent. You can be silent when death is there. You will suddenly see many things. Because death is not just a person stopping to breathe. Many things are happening. When a person dies, his aura starts subsiding. This is one of the phenomena that happens. If you are silent, you can feel it, an energy force, a vital energy field subsiding, getting back to the center. When a child is born, just the opposite happens. When a child is born, an aura starts spreading. It starts near the navel. It starts near the navel, just as when you throw a pebble in the lake, ripples start and they go on spreading to the shore. So too when a child is born, breath is like a pebble in the lake. When the child breathes, the navel center is hit. The first pebble has been thrown in the silent lake and the ripples go on spreading. Your whole life you go on spreading. Near about the age of 35, your aura is complete. It is at the peak. Then it starts subsiding. When a person dies, it goes back to the navel. When it reaches the navel, it becomes a concentrated energy. A concentrated life. If you are silent, you can feel it. You will feel a pull. If you sit near a dead man, you will feel as if a subtle breeze is blowing towards the dead man and you are being pulled. The dead man is contracting his whole life. The whole field that he was, many things starts happening around a dead man. If he loved a person very dearly, that means he had given a part of his life energy to that person. And when a person dies, immediately that part that he had given to another person leaves that person and moves towards the dead one. If you die here, your lover may be living far away in London. Something will leave your lover immediately because you have given a part of your life and that part will come back to you. That is why when a loved one dies, you feel that something has left you as well. Something in you has died also. A deep wound, a deep gap will exist now. Whenever a lover dies, something in the beloved also dies, because they were deeply involved with one another. And if you have loved many people, for example, if a person like Dozo or a Buddha or a Bahauddin or a Raman dies, from all over the universe, energy moves back to the center. It is a universal phenomenon. He is involved with so many, many millions of lives, and from everywhere his energy will come back. The vibrations that he has given to many will leave and they will move to the original source. They will become again a concentration near the navel. If you watch, you will feel ripples coming back in a reverse order. When a child breathes for the first time, it is like a stone is thrown into the silent lake, and ripples starts rising and moving towards the shore. If you watch, you will feel the ripples coming back in the reverse order when a person is dying, and when they are totally concentrated in the navel, you will see a tremendous energy, a light aura, and then that center leaves the body. When a man dies, that is simply a stopping of the breath, and you think he is dead. He is not dead as yet. Indeed, it takes time. Sometimes if a person has been involved in millions of lives, it takes many days for him to recede back into his center and die. That is why with sages and saints, particularly in the East, we never burn their bodies. Only saints are not burned. Otherwise, everyone else's body is burned, because others' involvement is not so much. Within minutes, the energy gathers and they are no more part of this existence. But with saints, the energy takes time. Sometimes it goes on and on. That is why if you go to Shirdi, to Sai Baba's town, or the shrine of Lalaji, or Braj Mohan Lal, or Ramakrishna, or Raman, you will still feel something is happening. Still the energy goes on coming. He is so much involved that for many people he is still alive. The tomb of Sai Baba and the shrine of masters are not dead. When a Buddha dies, he will be involved in many of you. And if you can feel, then a sage remains alive for many years, sometimes thousands of years, because life is not only of the body, life is an energy phenomenon. Life is not only of the body, life is an energy phenomenon. It depends on the involvement and how many people, how many persons he has been involved in. I go on posting on the social media. Whenever anyone reads it, clicks a like or posts a comment, the person is immediately connected to me, and through Buddha cognition I am connected to that person. The involvement is established. It depends on the level of involvement, how many persons he was involved in. And a person like Buddha is not only involved with persons, instead he is involved even with trees, birds, animals. His involvement is so deep and profound that if he dies, his death will take at least 500 years to complete. So you feel the person is still alive. Buddha is reported to have said, "My religion will be life force for only 500 years. And the meaning is there because he will be a life force for 500 years. It will take 500 years for him to get out of the involvement totally. When death happens, be silent and watch." All over the world, whenever you pay respect to dead men, you become silent. A silence is observed for 2 minutes, but we do not know why. This tradition has been continued all over the world. But why silence? When you are visiting a sick person, it is said to stand on the right side of the person. Even a person who is now no more alive, you stand on the right side of that person and be silent. Be meditative. The tradition is meaningful. You may not know why, you may not be aware, and your silence may be filled with inner chattering, and you may do it just like a ritual. That is up to you, but the secret is there. Be respectful and meditative in that moment when a person's breathing has stopped, but the process of death has not completed. The energy has not receded into this very source of life. It is important to know what happens in the moment.